everyone, it's Hailey, and today I'm going to be doing a spoiler-free review as well as a spoiler discussion for Caraval by Stephanie Garber. So this is going to be the first video where I try out the new format on my reviews, so the first little bit will be spoiler-free, and then I'm going to dive into a spoilery discussion, so I will let you know when I'm switching over to spoilers so you can go and read the book and then come back and watch the spoilery discussion part. I'm just kind of trying out something new, we'll see how it works out, and yeah, I'm just really excited to talk about this book because, spoiler alert, I loved it. And that wasn't the real spoiler alert. We'll get to that later. And I was sent this book for a review by the publisher Flatiron Books, as well as the audiobook by Macmillan Audio, so thank you so much to them for sending this to me. I have read it once and listened to it once, and both times I literally fell in love and just, oh, this book. If you follow me on Twitter, you know how much I loved it, or on Goodreads. It was amazing. Let's just get into the review. So I'm going to give you a really brief synopsis because I think this is one of those books where you just need to kind of dive into it. It follows Scarlett and her sister, and they are living in a very oppressive household, and they have always dreamed about going into Caraval and escaping there. It's basically this just crazy dark kind of carnival-esque thing. It's very hard to describe. It kind of resists any description, but that's what makes it amazing. So they escape into this magical world, and she ends up on this adventure following these clues. It's this whole mystery story, and that's all I'm going to tell you, because really, just go into it. You just know it's about sisters, and it's about this carnival thingy, and it is awesome. The writing of this book was absolutely beautiful. This is a debut novel, which is like just so shocking to me because the writing is just so well seasoned, I guess. It's like it's a chicken, it's well seasoned. It's very easy to understand, but the descriptions are so well thought out that it transports you to this completely different world. And as the story unfolds and as the characters are kind of following these clues, you're along with them trying to figure out what is going on, because the world of Caraval is amazing and beautiful, so well built, and it really is kind of, like I said, resisting description, and it blurs the lines between reality and fantasy, and that's the whole concept of the story, is that the lines between fantasy and reality are really not as stark as they may seem, and that's kind of what the whole story is about. So as the lines are blurred for the characters, it's also blurred for you, so you have no idea what's really happening and what is just her imagination or what is just pretend. Like, you have no idea what is going on the whole course of the book, but that is what makes it amazing. And like I said, the descriptions of the world and of the characters just creates this vivid picture for you, so it's a very easy story to get yourself lost in and to kind of transport to a completely different, crazy world. Scarlett was the main character in this book, and I really enjoyed her. She's kind of the reclusive one, like, she's all about protection rather than living this crazy life, whereas her sister, Tella, is all about adventure and going out there and living your life. So I found it interesting because I could relate to both of them. I think I related more so to Tella just because of the way she acted, and she was the younger sister, and I am the youngest of three girls, so I can completely relate to that, but at the same time, I did feel like bits and pieces of Scarlett I felt like I could connect with. She's kind of afraid, and really her focus is protecting her sister, and their relationship was beautiful. I thought that the fact that the story wasn't so much about romance but focused more so on sisterhood was one of its strengths, because sisterhood is something really beautiful, and I just loved reading about it. And like I said, Scarlett was just an excellent character to have the perspective from, because she was just fiercely loyal to her sister, and she's intelligent, and you really got to see her have a nice character arc throughout the story, which was another strength of this book through the writing, was the fact that every character had a nice arc, so you didn't feel like one character was kind of left behind. They all had a very nice story. The plot of this book was awesome. It was kind of like a world where the Mad Hatter was in charge, and that is just a crazy world. It was this game that's like the Hunger Games, like you don't know what is going on, and it is just craziness, but it was so dark, but at the same time really fun and just magical. It was so weird, but it honestly, it just takes you right away. Like, the audiobook was awesome because you kind of got that atmosphere through hearing it, but even in the writing, you still got that really atmospheric story that was similar to the Night Circus, which was really what I was looking for, because when you think of like a carnival or a circus, you're kind of thinking of a certain atmosphere, and it did really come through with this story. The whole plot plot was kind of centered around them following these clues, and it was kind of like this puzzle coming together that kept you guessing the whole entire time, which was really enjoyable. So it was a very interactive read. It was an experience to read it, to say the least. So overall, I gave this book a 5 out of 5 stars, and now I'm going to be diving into the spoilery section. So if you haven't read this book yet, then go and read it. I highly encourage it. It is just so amazing, and I think you will love it. It's just, oh my god, so good. So go and get yourself a copy, and then come back, and we can discuss it. Okay, so the first scene of this book, when you're introduced to the sisters and the father, I think was very telling about how their personalities end up being throughout the course of the story, because you see that the father is, his sole purpose is really, he's trying to break them apart and kind of break their sisterhood. He sees them as property, which is kind of a very Victorian ideal. This had a very Victorian setting, which I enjoyed because I love reading about anything Victorian, but you see him trying to tear them apart because of the fact that when one of them misbehaves, the other gets punished. So he's trying to break down their relationship, but in doing so, he really strengthens it. And that kind of set up the whole story. Like, you saw how Tella said that it was, she said that it was Scarlet, so then she would be punished, whereas it was actually her. And it was just really sad to read about, but I think it set up the whole story perfectly because you saw how beautiful their relationship was and how much it had overcome, and just the strength of it was so nice to read about. And you could kind of see why she had been wanting to go to Caraval for the whole time, like why she had been writing to Legend for 7 years, because Caraval represented this just magical escape from the kind of hell that they were living in. So it represented a land where they could be free and they can do whatever and participate in this crazy game. And they had heard stories from their grandmother for so long that it just sounded like the ideal place for them to be, where they could be free from their father's shackles. Now, Tella, you really don't see a lot of in this book, but I thought that when you did see her, you found out a lot about who she was, and you still got a solid character arc for her. So in the beginning, you see her with Julian, and they end up taking Scarlet away, and she says to Scarlet, "There's more to life than staying safe." And I thought that that whole quote kind of enveloped the story, and it really showed what Scarlet believed versus what Tella believed, and it showed how different they were, and it showed intelligence for both of them, I think, if that makes any sense. Like, Tella was smart enough to know that that is how her sister feels. Her sister solely believes that she has to protect Tella, and that is her job, and she doesn't really care about protecting herself. She wants to protect her sister. And I think Tella's way of giving back to her sister and protecting her was to get her out of that house and get her out of that toxic environment that really turned her into a mother figure where she couldn't really have her own childhood. I love the fact that there were so many flashbacks in this book, because I think it gave you a really good overview of the whole story and how they had come to the place that they were, like how the whole thing worked. It gave just this whole picture, so it wasn't just a little bits and pieces, you got the whole picture. And it was honestly like a puzzle, because you had the clues kind of going here, then you had the flashbacks going here, like the present day. It all kind of fit together in the end, and I just thought it worked so well. Now, the first introduction when you actually get to Caraval was in the clock shop, which I thought was so appropriate, because time is a huge focus of this story, because they are racing against the clock to save Tella, and there's just never enough time. Like, she's giving away 2 days of her life here. Like, it's all about time and how it works and how it's weird. Like, time works differently in Caraval. It was just so appropriate, I think, that it started off in a clock shop. And also, when the clock shop owner asked to borrow her voice, and she would be able to go into Caraval through this secret entrance that would lead her right to the center, I thought that was a very Ariel-esque moment, and it really did introduce you to the world of Caraval and how it was really about, like, kind of bargaining and bartering, and not in the typical way that you would imagine, which I thought it was just, I kind of wish she would have given away her voice, because then it would have turned into this cool Ariel thing, but at the same time, I'm glad she didn't. Now, when Scarlet got to Tella's room, and they were all, like, all the people were pillaging it because they're trying to find clues, because they know that finding Tella will lead to them winning Caraval, it was just like, I would have lost it if I got in there, and like, if my sister was missing and someone had taken, like, gone in her room and were like, oh, what's this, and like touching everything, I would have lost it. So like, props to Scarlett for not completely losing it, because I would have just gone off on everyone and been like, who are you? Why are you touching? Why? Just stop. Now I want to talk about Julian for a second. Julian, I think, was a confusing but very intriguing character, and as you kind of found out his backstory, and especially when you find out that he is acting in Caraval and that Legend is his brother, like, it added so much dimension to his character, and I have so many questions now, like, and I hope that they're gonna be answered in book two, because I need a book two. Just gonna throw this in here, the epilogue was like, I need book two now. Like, I think that the fact that it's going to be focused on Donatella is awesome, because I think she was such an intriguing character, and like I said, one who I could really relate to. She's kind of reckless and just doesn't really think about her decisions, I feel like, and just kind of goes for it, and I could kind of relate to that in one way, but like I said, in some respects I'm like Scarlett, kind of a mix of the two. But anyways, I think that seeing her on a crazy adventure would be awesome, and I'm so looking forward to getting a story about her in book two, and just, yes, I need it now. But anyways, getting back to Scarlett, when she went to the fortune teller and asked about who she was gonna marry rather than asking about Tella first, I think that was kind of one of the, like, the main moment where you saw her character arc and how far she had come. There is a moment later when she finally stands up to her father. That's kind of, I feel like, the final moment where you see her standing her ground and you see that she is a completely new person. But when she asks about something for herself rather than finding her sister, I think that showed that she was really starting to change, and she was starting to protect herself rather than just protecting her sister. And even when the Count comes with her father and she, like, sprays him with the poison or whatever it was, the elixir, and then ties him to the bed, you see her really standing up for herself, and it was nice to kind of see that development in her and see her as a character who really stood up for who she was and kind of breaking out of the Victorian mold of being her father's property, and him, like, the Count paid a lot of money for her so she should do whatever she wants, and she's like, no, like, I'm no one's property. And I was just like, yes girl, yes. Now the thing with the scene where Tella gave away 2 days of her life, I was like, I thought it was funny, because she was like, she was kind of reluctant, but she was like, okay, like, it's 2 days, she's assuming at the end of her life, so she's like, whatever. But then it ends up being now, and all of a sudden she starts freaking out, and she's like, no, like, I don't have a lot of time. But like, even so, if you're dying and you give away 2 days, like, wouldn't you want those extra 2 days? I don't know, that whole thing just made me think. That was a real, like, life thinker. And that also brings me to the point of, death in this book was, like, really fluid. It didn't really, it was kind of inconsequential, I think is the word that I'm looking for. That's probably not the word, inconsequential, like, it had no consequences. I can't think of that word right now, but it really was, like, nothing. And it, the funny thing was, everyone else knew that except for Scarlett. Like, to Scarlett, she thinks that when Dante dies, he's actually dead. When Tella dies, she actually died. When, what's his name? Julian dies, that he's actually dead. So this is really, like, mind-boggling for her, and she's really upset about it. But then it ends up being, oh no, you die, but then you come back to life again and everything's fine. And I found that a little bit confusing, but I had to read that part, like, a few times over where they explained that, but I thought it was interesting, and it added an interesting idea to the element of the lines being blurred between reality and fantasy, because it was kind of the lines being blurred between life and death. And I think the fact that there were so many dreams in this book also helped that, because when you're sleeping, like, you're not really conscious. You're not, like, you're conscious, but you're, like, you don't really know what's going on, so you're kind of, like, it's almost like you're dead, and, like, in a dream you're alive, so it's just, like, this mind-boggling thing where, like, life and death, there was just this little area between the two that a lot of the story existed in. Also, the scene where she died, I loved the chapter opener where it said death was the color purple. Also, I'm quoting from an ARC, so if these have changed, I'm sorry, it's just, it's not out yet, so I can't check it against the actual finished copy, but it says death is the color purple. And I loved that. Like, just the chapter openers for this book were amazing and just so good. Just, oh my god, the writing was just fabulous. The scene with the tunnels and when they go into, like, I think they're in a room, but when Julian and Scarlett go into this room and then it's like pushing them closer together, and then they find out that it's reading their emotions. I thought that was really funny, and I thought it was a good kind of lead up to when they first kind of confess their feelings to each other. You first started to see how much Julian cared for Scarlett when she was dying for the 2 days, and you saw him kind of caring for her and being like, what have you done? Like, it was this whole scene where you saw that he really did have feelings for her, and you saw her feelings come out for him when he was injured. Like, there were just these little hints, and then I think when they finally did end up having like that kind of moment where they confessed their feelings and they had their first kiss and all that, I think it showed their whole relationship, because they were still kind of had that fun banter, and it was just a really nice moment. Also, about the way that Julian died, I thought it was kind of funny, because it was like this nice little paragraph, and it was like, it would have been nice if he hadn't had a knife to the chest. Like, it was just kind of quick little jabs. That was a good pun. Jabs like that, that like the writing was just very fluid, and those things just kind of fit in. So it had like a mix of funny, a mix of seriousness, and just this book literally had everything, and I just loved it. So that is all for today's review. Like I said, I cannot wait for book two of this. I think it is going to be beautiful. I hope you guys enjoyed the new spoilery format. I hope it's not too long of a video, because it is 20 minutes for me, but I don't know. We'll see. So yeah, I hope you guys enjoyed this video. Let me know if you have read this book, your thoughts on it, and actually if you're still here, you have read this book, so let me know your thoughts on it, and yeah, I will see you guys in the next video. Bye!